But how did you guys meet?
The gym.
No way.
I had seen him at the gym for a while.
She admits it now.
In the Shaza Z chat.
What's up, you guys? Welcome back to the Shaza Z chat. Today I have such an amazing couple. Mr. and Mrs. Boykins, they got married in the midst of COVID during the pandemic. Their love did not stop. COVID did not stop their love story from happening. Okay, period. So welcome, Mr. and Mrs. Boykins.
Hey.
Yes, I'm so happy that you guys are here.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Yes, like literally your pictures together as a family, your pictures as your bride, they just like went all the way up. And you were so pretty on your wedding day.
Thank you.
You were. And that garden, like I have not had a wedding at that venue yet.
You know, okay.
But that's such a beautiful venue though.
It is.
It's like a best kept secret. Mm-hmm. What's the name of it again?
Flint Hill.
Flint Hill. That garden?
Yeah.
It's so pretty.
Yeah.
What made you choose that venue? Like, how did you find that?
I actually found it because my line sister got married at their sister venue, which is the Atrium. So they have three venues in the city. They have the Atrium, Primrose Cottage, and that one. So I went to see the Atrium because I liked it. But then they were like, well, we're going to show you all three. And they showed me Flint Hill. And I was like, oh, no, it's this one.
Wow.
It's this one. So, yeah, just by happenstance and through her referral, I found that one. Stumbled across it, though.
Yeah.
I didn't go there looking to see that venue. So, yeah.
It's so magical. Like the garden in the front is beautiful. And then like the aisle, like where you had the wedding at, it was like the pebble stone and all the, like, it's like the backyard is pretty too with the lighting. It's so pretty.
Yeah. And initially we weren't going to do the reception in the courtyard, but because of the pandemic, we wanted to keep everything outside as much as possible. But the courtyard was beautiful. So it all worked out
the
way it was supposed to.
So beautiful. So let's start from the beginning. How did you and him meet? Because I know Brittany from Albany State, HBCU, Delta. She's my pro fight. Like, literally, Brittany crossed me to be a Delta.
He hates the ramp up. He hates the ramp up because he's a hater.
No. That's a part of I think we're in a cult, though. I think Albany State's like low-key a little bit of a cult because we'd be like literally like on the same page.
Yeah.
But Brittany crossed me as a Delta. Uh-huh. She was really like somebody I looked up to a lot in college. So like to see you like now, like what is it? Who was in college? It was 10 years? No. 20?
I've been out of college over 10 years because I graduated in 2009. So
mm-hmm. Are we that old now?
Yeah.
Dang, almost 30 years.
Yeah.
Back in the day, for real. But
it's been a minute.
Yes. But how did you guys meet?
The gym.
It's no way.
You mentioned that. Yeah.
Yeah, we met at the gym.
Did you really?
LA Fitness.
Mm-hmm. LA Fitness. Mm-hmm. It's an LA Fitness love story.
Yep.
Wow. Okay, so.
LA Fitness love story.
I know y'all have two different versions. Okay, so who want to go first? Who?
Oh, my God. Okay. I had seen him at the gym for a while.
She admits it now.
I had seen him, but, you know, he would never say anything, and I'm not going to approach you. You know, I definitely am the woman who wants to be approached. So I felt like, well, he must not be interested, but he would always kind of make eye contact. So
I said, okay,
well, when he gets his nerve up, he will say something to me. In the meantime, I'll just keep working out. And then finally, one day, he said something, and I can't remember what he said, honestly. I just know I was lifting weights, and he was in my proximity. And I went over to put my weights back up, and he said something, and I answered. And before I left the gym, he came over where I was stretching and asked me, could he walk me to my car? And I was like, okay. And he walked me out and got my number, and the rest is history.
Wait, okay, so how long was he like choosing at the gym? Like, how long were y'all?
I feel like it was like a year or two.
A year?
It was a minute. Like, I had been going to that gym probably for like 2-3 years before he ever said anything to me.
And you saw him the whole time?
I don't know if I saw him the whole time, but leading up to when he actually approached me, I had saw him consistently, at least every week.
Wow.
Yeah.
Were you looking forward to, like, when you got there, were you looking forward to seeing him, or were you just like,
I was your gym crush?
What, gym husband?
He was one of my, he was, no, I'm just kidding. No, he was my gym crush, yeah.
That's cute. I never even knew that was a thing.
Yeah.
A gym crush, like, that's so cute.
So, he finally got up the nerve and That's what happened.
Wow. And then he walked you to your car, mm-hmm. and then he asked for your number, and yep. then, like, he just been consistent ever since.
Ever since. Yeah, I can't get rid of him.
Why?
Just like, I don't want to get rid of him. Yeah. But no, seriously, like, we've been locked in since the day he got my number, so it's...
Yeah. Smitten. Y'all mm-hmm. are smitten for each other, though.
Yeah.
You guys are, like, still burning very strong. And yeah. it's been 3 years. Like, yeah. you know what I'm saying? Like, you guys, I feel like you guys are still in your honeymoon phase. Like, you guys travel all over the place. Y'all go out a lot. I always see in your social media, you guys go to different events together. You're taking pictures together. Like, I love how you guys show your affection and how y'all show y'all love to each other. It's super fun.
Yeah, you got to keep it spicy. Yeah. I feel like whatever you were doing when you were dating, you have to continue to do that through marriage, you know, or it'll get boring, it'll get stale. So yeah, we date, we're friends. I mean, he's my go-to. He kind of salty he can't go to the Beyonce show, but I'm like, you don't know her songs.
I don't understand.
And he really was like, I'm not going to the concert. I was like, sing me one song, the whole thing. So he kind of felt bad because that's a girl's day.
But, yeah, you know. That's cool. That's cute. So wait, okay, your side of the story. How did you guys meet in your version?
Okay, so it was never a nerve thing, to be honest. Like, the gym is one of the most thirstiest places ever. So you definitely don't want to come out like, I'm just running around here, like, shooting every shot that's in here.
Yeah.
So I would see her, and I think her little brother, I didn't know, like, you know, if any female would have dude, like, I kind of just dismiss it. Mm-hmm. No thirst here.
My little brother definitely looks like my little brother.
Wait, though. You thought her little brother was,
like,
her
because I would just be like in their business, but you know, like, I just see she would do, so I'm cool. And then, like, she started to be alone and started to keep making eye contact. And you know how, you know, rack those weights a little differently in front of me. With the arching at the back.
I'm so weak.
Even the day when I did get her number, like, it still was, she don't like to admit it, but she threw the bait. Like, as much as a woman can.
What was the bait? What bait did I throw?
Like, just keep, you know, sending the sign.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So.
Do you concur? Or?
I don't recall.
Okay, because
I won't confirm or deny. I don't remember throwing any bait. I thought I was working out.
And she was in my business. Took the headphone out. When the headphone comes out in the gym, it's go time.
Because you said something to me. That's why the headphone came out.
I mouthed something to you.
And so I'm like, what did you say?
Yeah, what did you say?
Probably nothing.
and she answered, but that's too funny. Okay, so then what? Like,
So she continues to work out. I think some other dude bothered her, and she comes tell me or something like that.
Are you kidding me right now? So now you're gonna start embellishing, because that never happened.
Tell the truth. The dude took your weight or something like that, and you told me.
Oh, okay. I remember now. Okay.
Yeah, I came to the rescue.
Oh, wait. So if somebody took her weight.
Something like that.
And then you like kind of like, hey, give her weight back or something like that?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's cute. So he cared.
And then, so I think she was stretching. I'm on the way out the door. She look up again. You know.
I just don't appreciate how he's trying to make me so thirsty in the dialogue. It's very, very much like I just threw my number to you. And that's not what happened. Okay. In his world.
So I walked into a car. We sat out there about 20 minutes. Yeah. It was raining. Umbrella.
It was raining.
Oh, so you was committed. To walk her into her car.
I mean, you know.
Dang. And then what? So what made you ask her for a number? Like, what was it about Brittany that was like, okay, I need to get her number to, like, get to know her?
Okay. Well, I think the first time I saw her, or second, third, somewhere around there, and I was actually headed out and she was coming in, and it was like, you like some movies.
I was heading out like, and you were coming in. I was leaving, you were coming in.
No.
Yeah.
I remember.
Okay.
So, and it was like, you know, like in a movie when you're walking, everything's noisy, catch eyes, and everything goes quiet. And it was like, quiet, she passed, and the noise came back. Really? So I was like,
make him go Dale.
That's true.
He always say that. Then I make you go Dale. Tell them. That's what happened because you said it wasn't no noise when you saw me. Right. I made you go there?
Pretty much.
Yeah.
That's wow. That's powerful.
It was.
You know?
He knew then. So then he decided, let me just go ahead and get it because I can't hear it without her.
See there?
You know?
I mean, she's a catch.
Period.
She's definitely a catch. She's a baddie. Got her weight down, got her body together. One thing Brittany told me, she said, you know, ain't no reason why I shouldn't be in shape. Well, ain't no reason why my weight should be out of control. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, that's true. Like, people got to keep stay on top of it. Mm-hmm.
I agree.
So do you guys prioritize health and fitness into your relationship?
Yeah. I would say it's something that we are individually passionate about. We met at the gym. So obviously both of us were into fitness and being healthy before we even met. So that's just something we have in common. And then with my background in nursing, of course, being healthy is super important to me. I take care of sick people all day. So I am not trying to become what I take care of. I'm not trying to become a patient. So for us, the way we eat, the food that I buy, the way I cook, all of that is kind of how it joins. But he'll go to the gym on his own. We don't even go to the same gym anymore, actually, because my the gym we were going to, they didn't have classes early enough for me. And I decided that in this year, I would work out before I started my day. So I'm at the gym at 5:30, 6 in the morning, and they're not open then. So, but yeah, so I would say working out has been important to both of us. And our eating habits have changed a lot since we've been together. We've gone on vegan journeys, plant-based journeys. Are we just kind of vegan adjacent now, I guess?
Yeah, I think that that's really important.
Yeah.
Because that improves your well-being, that improves your mood.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It improves your energy towards each other. And I think that's a form of self-care.
Mm, definitely.
When you take care of yourselves, you're able to be there for each other. So I love that. Yeah. That's very, very dope.
And I always tell him, he got to do whatever I do because I don't want him to be a patient. You know, the statistic is women outlive their husbands. Mm. But I want him to grow old with me and be able to take care of himself when we're 85 and 90, not like I'm wheeling him around. That's God forbid something tragic happens, but not for anything that we can prevent, like our diet and our lifestyle.
That's true. And the fact that you have that in front of you every day, like you can take care of him. Like that's really cool that you actually have that skill that you do every single day. Mm-hmm. Wow. Okay. So when it comes to your wedding day, let's talk wedding day.
Okay.
So what is one of your most cherished moments on your wedding day? What is your most cherished moment on your wedding day?
Coming down the aisle for sure. And first dance. First dance was amazing. And he fought me tooth and nail about that smoke cloud. He did not see the value in the smoke cloud. But when the smoke cloud released on our wedding day, he really was like, oh. Like we were dancing and he was like, this is dope.
She was going for every upsell that anybody presented.
Yeah, let's do it. And she go big or go home.
I wanted the smoke cloud and I did want the monogram floor. I let the monogram floor go. I realized it wasn't as big of a priority, but the first dance was definitely a good time and it incorporated our whole family. So the first dance for me, yeah.
I love y'all first dance.
Yeah.
Because y'all had a good intro too.
Yeah.
Did y'all plan that? Like, did y'all rehearse that?
Yeah.
Really? Okay, so how did that practice go? Like, did y'all was like, okay, so we're going to do this and we do that? Like,
oh, our first dance intro? Like, walking in?
Yeah.
Oh, like, no, we
that
just
was freestyle.
Dance. Yeah, we just did whatever.
Wow. And then y'all practiced y'all's.
We practiced our family dance.
Oh,
we didn't
practice
our
soul
dance.
But
we practiced our family dance.
Yeah.
We practiced
that's
that.
So cute.
Yeah.
You know, speaking of, oh, wait, let me ask you, what was your most cherished moment?
I think the vows, because you know, like I knew she would out-talk me, out-vow me.
I love that. Yeah, the vows were good.
I got emotional. I didn't expect to be that emotional about my vows, but yeah, vows were good.
Yeah, the vows were really sweet.
Yeah,
I'm trying to think back on like those moments because I feel like walking down the aisle is like because you guys didn't do a first look, so you guys really saw each other for the first time down the aisle. So what was like going through your head? Like, do you remember like what was going through your head when you was walking down the aisle?
I don't remember exactly. I just remember being really happy and really excited. And you know what I remember? I remember counting those seats, trying to figure out who wasn't there. Because
no, for real.
Because you pay so much, you know, for a wedding, for people to like no show on the day of. So I remember looking around like, these empty chairs, I am not okay, you know? But once I got down the aisle and got in front of him, everything was great. But yeah, I do remember looking at the empty seats like, who didn't come to my wedding?
Wow. No, for real. Because you want to think about the money, but hold on. That's $2,000.
right. Like you count, like you're calculating, like as you go down, you're like 100, 200, 300, 400. Yeah, but.
And most of the people who were no show, it's like it was the people who begged the most to be there. And the people who really.
For sure.
I'm like, I didn't even want to invite you. Like, how you do all that and not show?
On his side, for sure. Like, I would say, in all honesty, the people who on my side could not come, they had like really legitimate things going on, still sent gifts, still sent money. So it was like, you know, okay, you couldn't be here, but you made sure the love was felt. But yeah.
I love that.
It was a little sketchy.
So I said that I'm not talking to as of right now.
You fell out with
you
people.
You owe me money. You owe me money.
Big time fell out with people.
Like, should people pay a deposit to come to a wedding? Like, maybe.
I would think so. I just think they should keep their word, you know? And also for people who are having a wedding, I also think you probably should minimize the fluff. Like, we had a very intimate wedding. Our guest count was like 85. Because I didn't want fluff. I wanted people that were, who meant something to the both of us in our really inner circle, you know? Because oftentimes those are the people who don't show, like the people who are not invested in you enough. You get what I'm saying? And so for us, our wedding day was about who's been invested in me and him this entire time, you know?
Yeah, I love that. That's important because after the wedding day, after everything, all the dust settles, who's really calling y'all, checking on you, see how you doing?
Nobody. And that's who we wanted at our wedding. So, yeah.
So speaking of y'all's family dance, that was super cute. I love your kids. Your kids are so adorable. Like, they're so full of life.
Yeah.
Like, their energy is, like, so vibrant. I'm just like, wow. Like, they are literally, like, little angels.
Yeah.
And I love them. Like, they were so sweet. And you could tell, like, you guys have a very strong bond. Like, you can tell that you're a good dad. You know what I'm saying? You could tell that they love you. You know what I'm saying? You can tell that you guys really worked on that family dynamic.
Sure.
So how did you guys work on that family dynamic? How did that happen? Like, how did it become so, like, cohesive?
I think it was more just time and effort, to be honest.
So like time, like what do you mean? Like, did you guys like go out on trips? Did you guys go on trips together?
Quality time, yeah, like plenty of quality
we did trips,
time.
Like cabin trips, you know,
Florida,
boiling sports. So she would always come support them at their games, and
you know. Yeah, I think quality time is important. And he's a good father. Like, he's a great father. That's definitely one of the things that appealed to me most about him. As someone who grew up without their dad, it was super important that when, you know, okay, we're dating, oh, you have kids, what kind of dad are you, you know? So the fact that he was very hands-on with his children, actively in their life, that was super appealing to me. And so once I met the children, like once we decided we were serious about each other, and I'm like, okay, well, let me meet your children. It was really organic. Like, it was almost kind of scary how easily they gravitated towards me. And of course, being a bonus mom, it was a learning curve, because honestly, he was the first person I ever seriously dated with children. So it was like, okay, where do I fit in? What do I do? What do I say? So a lot of my concerns are just whatever I felt, I would channel it through him. And then he would kind of be like, well, this is what I think, or, you know. But honestly, I just trusted my instincts when it came to the children, and always tried to just be a place of love and understanding, and really just a soft place to land. And truly, I'm a big kid at heart. I think that helps. Like, I am a child at heart. So I love playing games. I like having dance-offs. We have rap battles. So I think we relate because I'm really one of them in just the older body.
Yeah. You are fun girl.
Yeah. I like to have a good time. So, and I love children. Even before meeting his children, I was a pediatric nurse for 10 years. So children are my soft spot.
Yes.
So it was no different. If you love him, which I do, I automatically love what comes from him. So, yeah.
And, you know, that's huge that, you know, if you love him, then you love whatever comes with him. And I think that's important because, you know, a lot of women may be like, oh, well, I have a checklist. He can't have this. He can't have this. He can't have no kids. And I'm just like, you know, I hate that women like just scratch that off the list, because at the end of the day, like, you never know what God could be blessing you with.
That's true.
You know what I'm
saying?
That's true. So having that closed mind, you know, some women do miss out on their blessing.
That's true. I think it's okay to have standards or whatever. And if you're a person that says, okay, I don't date people with children, that's your prerogative. That was never, I never had that outlook. I was always kind of like, they have to be a good dad if they have children, and they have to have a stable situation. I'm not walking into any rigmarole. So as long as the home situation is stable and they are an active and present father, I never was anti someone having children. I've always looked at children like a blessing. And I have four children that I didn't birth who I love and who love me. And I just feel very blessed. You know, we have a huge family already. We plan to expand our family very soon. And one of my line sisters will tell you, she was like, I feel like you manifested this life. She's like, when we were online, do you remember saying you wanted 7 kids? And I was like, no. And she was like, you always say, I want a house full of kids. I want a house full of kids. And now I have a house full of children. And I love it here. So, yeah, they are full of love. And, again, I can't wait to expand. They're like, hoping and wishing for siblings. So, God willing, soon enough.
Yes, because I remember, I don't know if you said it in your vow or if it was a post on Instagram, because you're not be following you, but I'm like, you said people don't know how much I needed them too.
Yeah, for sure.
Bring up vows.
Right? For sure.
And I love that, because yeah. That's huge, because it's like, you know, when you actually meet people and cross paths with like beautiful people, it's like, I need them too.
Yeah, for sure. They give unconditional love. That's something that is invaluable.
And kids are honest too.
Yeah. Oh my God. Very honest. Extremely honest, but it's good. You know, I appreciate the honesty. So.
And what about you as being a father? Like you are, for me, just being there for a couple of hours, I could just tell that your children love you. You're a good father. So like, where did you learn those like models? Like, where did you learn how to be a good father?
I have a dad, but it wasn't like the close relationship. Mm-hmm. So you kind of learn, you know how sometimes you'll learn what you want to be by what you don't have. Mm-hmm. So it's either you're going to do what you're showed or you're going to do the opposite. Mm-hmm. So yeah. It's kind of like I took that role to give them everything I didn't have. And I can kind of tell where my dad went wrong and know like how to learn a lesson from that.
Yeah, like you want to, like, you're always supposed to be better than your parents, you know, like you're always supposed to do what you, I think that's the best way to learn is like what you didn't have make a difference in the next, in your life. So that's beautiful. I love that. And you know, in this day and age, it's rare to have good fathers in the homes, you know, like in a Black parent, it's rare to have fathers in the home. So the fact that you're there for your children, I love that. Yeah. Now, quick question. I know this is kind of like off to the side, but how has your childhood defined what love means to you, or like defined love to you? Like, how has your childhood defined what love means to you?
I would say I grew up on love. My mom is my biggest fan.
Yes.
Ever. Number one supporter. If you meet my mom, you know about her children.
Yes.
Okay. She loves all of us to the moon and back. So for me, I always needed somebody who had me on that same pedestal, you know, who treated me like a queen, who, I'm not going to say worshiped the ground I walked on, but just understood my value. And that's never been a question here. I've always been loved very well. I've always been on a pedestal. I've always been semi-spoiled.
Yeah.
And I've always gotten queen treatment. And it's not, I mean, I didn't have to kick and scream for it. You know, it was just very much like, I see you and this is what you deserve and this is what I'm going to give you. So I would say my mother laid the foundation for how I was supposed to be treated, with how she treated me and what she taught me. And once I went out into the world and started dating, nothing less than like pure love and adoration was going to do. And that's what I have here.
Yeah, so, he loves you some me.
I
do.
And yeah, nothing less. I couldn't do the wishy-washy, the halfway, the I ain't sure. And I tell my single girlfriends that, like, if you're unsure, that's a sign, because love is not uncertain. It's a lot of things. But if you ever have to question, do he like me? Why I ain't heard from him? Move on. Move on.
Yeah.
Because it would never be that if he was for sure. It would never be that.
That's true.
I feel like we went on a date every day.
Every day?
He locked in very fast. And I was thinking, like, let me kind of back up a little bit. Because, you know, you're thinking, he might get tired of me. Like, you know, he wants to see me all the time. He wants to be around me all the time. But here we are, 7 years later, 8 years knowing each other, 7 years later together. And this year will be 3 years married.
Wow. That's beautiful.
It don't take me long.
I love that.
Yeah.
Because you've been working, you know, in the nursing, you know, department and things like that. But it's always good to just show your true passions.
Yeah, creativity. And I say, like I always tell everybody, this life is long. You don't have to do one thing. you know?
Period. Okay, so how has your childhood helped you define what love is?
Like based on my childhood, again, coming from like a single mother, I think the love she showed was more so like the way we were growing up, it was more so like survival. Like she loved you, but she trying to make sure like don't that bad happen to you, you don't get caught up in anything you can't do. So I think like even with my parenting, like that's my approach. Cause it's so much that happened with kids now. Yes. Like I'm more so like, I guess the love, it come with like understanding and protection. So I think my love is more so that like understanding and protection.
Understanding and protection. I love that. That's very important. Wow. Okay. So how was it transitioning from living alone to like living together?
Like again, we were spending so much time together. It wasn't a big jump for me, so.
It wasn't?
It was a jump for me.
Was it?
Yeah. This is the first man I've ever lived with. And so just having to share space, and I'm an only girl, not only child, but I have brothers. So I never really had to share my stuff growing up because, and then we're 5 and 10 years apart. So it's kind of like we were in different phases of our life at different times. But yeah, nobody was going in my room using my stuff, you know. So to find that, okay, you're sharing a towel sometime or somebody's using this or just somebody else who's like not only your clutter, but now their clutter. For me, I kind of have a little bit of OCD. And to be honest, he doesn't have that problem. You know, he's not as OCD as me when it comes to like, how the pillows are on the couch, where the blanket is, you know, why is your robe on the floor and not on the hanger that I put there for it? So just those little things. But outside of that, I mean, it is on the positive. It's very nice to have someone to come home to every day, to look forward to eating dinner with, watching shows with. It's very comfortable, you know.
So, it's like a sleepover.
Exactly, every day. The person you debrief your day with, you decompress with. But it did take a little bit of getting used to. And even still now, I'm learning how to not, I guess, nag or nitpick on certain things. Like, because I have a lot of little nitpicky things that I could go on and on about. So I'm trying to just like, okay, just pick up the robe and hang it up just so that I can pick my battles.
Yeah, that's true. You do have to pick your battles.
So that everything is not World War III because everything is not worth the argument.
Cause I just don't understand, like, why are the drawers on the floor?
I don't either.
And why they just can't go on the carpet? Mm-hmm. Like, go on, you know what I'm saying? It's just a little thing. It's just like...
Yeah, you drop your pajama pants where you stand. Them pajama pants be where you left them in the morning. But let him tell it, he's trying to not cut the lights on to wake me up. So he forgot the pants was there.
Didn't dress in the dark.
In his defense, he does get up very early for work. So maybe he forgot the pants.
Man, I don't know about that. I'm just joking. But listen, I think 99% of guys.
I've let that go. I share my skincare.
Wait, you do skincare too?
Now.
So wait, is that true? Did you teach him his skincare routine? Like, you know
he has learned. Skin? Yeah. Yeah, he has learned.
Got rose water, the vitamin E.
Okay.
Eye cream. Yes. He does all the things now, but he learned just, you know, tapping over into my stuff. Yeah.
And that's good though, because look, men's skin is important to you.
It is. They have skin. It needs to be cared for just like ours. So yeah. Yep.
Okay. Let me see. What is the first thing you noticed about him?
His smile.
What is the first thing you noticed about her?
Probably the same. Smile, body. It was like total package.
Mm. Total package.
I gave her a quick scan, head to toe. That'll
popping. That worked. She a 10. Period. Okay, so what is one of your non-sexual turn-ons?
You want to go? You can go first.
I'm joking. I guess just talking to her, like time with her.
Yeah. Quality time.
Yeah.
That's cute. I like that.
I would say acts of service, especially doing things around the house, blowing off the lawn, putting up wallpaper, putting up light fixtures. Things that I could do but don't know how to do, don't want to do. You know, he's very handy. He can repair the sink when it's draining. I mean, we don't have to call anybody for anything. I think maybe carpet cleaning, that's about it. And if he wanted to do that, he could do that too. Oh, wow. Pressure washing the house. But, so those things I love, yeah.
Woman, love a good chore around the house, baby. Woo, do a load of clothes.
You know, ain't nothing like hearing that mower going on Saturday morning. You look out the window, he blowing those leaves around. You like, yeah, we gotta clean up that backyard. So I would say those love things.
I love
those things.
I blow extra loud by the window.
Trying to wake me up. Oh, we got the window. Okay. We gotta put some turkey up, bacon on the grill. You know, number one, two.
Oh, yeah, guys, yeah. Want that attention?
Doing anything around the house, I definitely like for sure.
How did your last breakup prepare you for your spouse?
Hot seat.
I think just knowing, like, I wanted someone as ambitious, someone as goal-driven, and, you know, someone who trying to, you know, bring something to the table financially as well.
That's a good one. So you want some, you don't want somebody that's lazy. You want somebody who's, like, driven. I love that.
One of his equal.
Because, like, did you experience, like, the opposite? Like, somebody who wasn't?
So being, like, very young and, like, financially stable at an early age, you think like you can just handle anything. So a lot of things slide. And then the later on in life, you're like, you don't want to do nothing. You know? So it turned into a you don't want to do nothing to like now it's a burden.
A liability. Wow. That's a good one. What about you, Brittany?
I would say my previous relationships taught me to be that the relationship wasn't all about me, because I did get a lot of, like I said, princess treatment in my life. And I was, I had myself on a pedestal.
That's not the
Nobody way. Gonna love me like I love me, right? But at the same time, you're in a relationship to love on another person, to cater to them too, to serve them too. So I will say, in my relationships when I was younger, I was very much self-centered. And getting your heart broken will teach you that, like, okay, you got another person over here you got to, like, check on and make sure they're okay and make sure that their needs are being met and make sure that, you know, it's about the both of you all. So I think my last relationship taught me to be more of a servant in relationships and not in a, like, bended knee way, but on in a, are you okay? What do you need from me? What can I do to make your life easier? And I think that's our role in each other's life, is we're here to help make each other's lives easier and be teammates and partners, not just one person running back and forth for the other and not receiving anything. So reciprocity, the importance of reciprocity is what I learned from previous relationships.
Wow. Yeah. What's the word again?
Reciprocity.
Reciprocity.
Yeah, which just means, you know, you give as good as you get.
I love that. That is very true, because you can't let one person do most of the work.
No. I think, like they say, relationships shouldn't be 50-50. They should be 100-100. Both people giving their best, you know? And on some days, my best may look different because I'm tired. But on every day, I'm going to show up and do the best that I can.
You know? I love that. Yeah. Perfect. How would you describe y'all relationship in one word?
I think it's fun.
Fun.
We have a good time. Yeah.
You guys do have a good time.
Yeah, we have a good time together. It's important. We truly enjoy each other. And I think that honestly is what made the difference from him and my other relationships. Like, he is truly my best friend. He's the person I want to do everything with, you know, the person I want to tell about things. And early on in our relationships, when we hit a few rocky points, it was kind of like, oh, I don't like him right now, but who am I going to tell about such and such? You know what I'm saying? Like, so I kind of had to come back and talk, because I'm like, this is my friend. Like, this is my friend first and then my man. And I think that sustains us even through the parts of relationships where things can get monotonous. Things can get a little stale. I mean, once you've been with someone for a while, you have to work to keep it spicy. But above anything and everything, this is my friend. Yeah. And so I consider that in everything I do. Do I want to hurt my friend? before I say this, like, how would that make my friend feel? You know what I'm saying? So before the romance, like, I have a genuine love and respect for who he is as a person.
Yeah. You guys are a good match.
Thank you.
You can tell you guys take, you can tell that you take care of yourselves and you take care of each other.
And that's important.
I think that's important. You guys have self-care because you guys are like into fashion. Like, I like y'all's outfits
Thank you.
Yeah, I love it. Because you, that's kind of, wait, are you guys, are you Nigerian?
Yeah.
Are you really?
He is not.
Wait. No, because you know, like the, you look like one of those, dang it, what's the name of those singers? Like the, what's the name of that type of song? Like type of music?
Afrobeats.
Yeah. You look like an Afrobeat artist. You could be a little artist. Oh, okay. Yeah, don't it? A little, it's a glass.
Davido. Burna Boy.
It's a chain. Burna Boy. Okay. Okay, Brittany, so how'd you come up with your outfit?
I just go for vibes, you know. I was in the closet just playing around and I put it on and I was like, okay, this works. And yeah, put my gold boots on and
I like a little bustier,
little
don't try to cover it up now.
I don't want to get a people too much, but you know they want to.
It's cute. Okay, so last but not least, you're welcome. Okay, so last but not least, I'm gonna say two words. We're gonna play a little game, but I'm gonna say two words and you have to think of a song that has that word in it.
Okay.
So first, so I'm gonna say one word at a time. And you can go first, Brittany, and then you go second.
Okay.
Okay, so the word is, you got 10 seconds to sing a song. You gotta sing it too. Okay.
Oh, we have to sing the song.
Yeah, okay, let's see. Let me put my timer on.
So I can sing.
So the word is street.
That's what we're singing a song?
That has that word in it.
Street. All of this street love.
Wait.
All of this street love. Ain't that a Lloyd song? Street love.
You do got it. It is true. Hold on.
Uh-huh. I told you.
I
said
it.
Okay.
All of this street. See? Perfect. Well, guess what, you guys? That's a wrap.
That's it? All right.
That was so much fun. You guys always come through for me.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
No, seriously. I really appreciate you guys
coming out.
Because at the end of the day, like, you know, I have visions and I want to do things, but and I just want to, like, you know, use people that I know that have genuine, you know, hearts and souls and really, you know, be a part of what I'm trying to do. Because God gives me visions and I'm just like, I got to call Brittany. I got to call my friends and brides that I've worked with in the past. So I really appreciate y'all coming. Y'all did an interview with me on FaceTime Live back in the day. Uh-huh. Like, you guys really show up and I really, really appreciate it.
You are so welcome.
Wow. Until next time.
Until next time. What's up, y'all? I'm Brittany Muhammad Boykin.
What's up, guys? I'm Quinte.
And tune in and watch our interview on the Shaza Z Chats.